Hello everyone, welcome to part 12 module 1 computer networks. So what we were discussing so far, let me take the pen. So we were on this topic, functionalities of computer networks, and we saw we have certain functionality which are mandatory in nature, and out of these mandatory functions, so far I think we covered functionalities like error control, we saw in detail, then flow control, access control also, right? So these three things we saw in detail. Now we move on to our discussion on some other mandatory functionalities, including congestion control, multiplexing, demultiplexing, and addressing. So we will have a look into these things, and then we will move on to the optional functionality. So let's start with the next mandatory functionality, that is congestion. From the name itself, it will be clear for you. So the traffic, right, the network is reaching a situation where it is not able to handle the traffic which are being coming from different machine. You know, who is suffering from congestion in the sense, like many different devices will be connected to some common network device, right? It can be a switch. So in general, we can call it as a kind of switch. A number of devices are being connected to this, and this is again connected to some other main network device, a switch or a router or a gateway, depending on the type of functionality being done by this. Okay, and again another one. So and at the receiver side, we have again a number of devices connected like this. Now to this router itself, there will be some kind of connection coming from someone else, and he will in turn connect to many. So in this way, if you are seeing that, if you look at any network devices on the way, whether it is a switch or router or gateway, whatever it will be getting information in the form of say messages and or unit of it called packets from a number of other small networks or sub network, right? And now once it is, right, this is again just a process, right? So it have some special configuration, like it is something that is capable of working 24/7, you know, if you are looking at Cisco switch and all, it's a very promising one, but still, you know, it have some limitation on handling the packets. So in assume a situation where maybe if you are looking at the timing, right, the say evening, some 6 to 7, 6 to 8, that timing, you know, most of the time when you're trying to get this network access, you are getting means most of the information which we are being sent, you may not be getting the correct response at the right time. You will face some kind of delay. And why this delay? Okay, so the delay is in the sense, you know, this is a peak time, say all people are active at that time. So normally, you know, thousands of or ten thousands or millions of machines being connected to their particular network device, and on an average, if a subset of all those users were connected, things will work fine. But when it comes to that peak rate, right, when all those machines are being connected to this, maybe everybody want access. So if look at some peak timing like this, maybe up to 10 it will go like this. And during this time, when everyone try to send some information, and this network device reach a situation where it can't handle more, and it will start dropping the message. So what means, it is having some capacity, right? It's just a machine only, right? So it has some capacity, it will try to perform to its maximum capacity, but if it is getting some information more than what it can handle, so that is a point where we call that the network is having the problem of congestion. And what it will do, it will drop some of the packets, and definitely your the information which you send may not received at the receiver side, and you will be getting some kind of delay from the response because the receiver didn't get your packet so far, and you have to resend. And when you are resending again, situation will be more dangerous. In that, you keep on resending without knowing the fact that it is being dropped, right? So that recent information also come into this network device, and altogether it will increase the traffic more. So it is something an exponential process, right? The congestion, once it started, if you couldn't control it properly, it keep growing exponentially, right? Exponentially in the sense, means what is the delay for a particular time? Maybe after few time, the delay will be doubled, in the sense the traffic is getting doubled, because nobody is ready to quit by himself. When even though you find the network to be delay, you will keep trying. So on the background, every trial is actually sending some packet to the network. So there should be some proper way of controlling this traffic, and this you can done at the sender side itself, right? So whenever some machine is sending information, don't let the information flow into the network. Means we call it as something like just keep a steady rate of data flow. So so we call something like bursty data. Bursty data in the sense, for a long time you are not trying to send any data, but at some point you want to send the data. Instead of sending it in a steady rate, you will quickly enter the whole thing as a bursty traffic. Okay, so maybe so instead of that, you maintain a steady data, right, at the center side itself. So this is what we call as traffic shaping. So you are trying to shape the traffic, means on the background this operating system will do this for you. Okay, so even though the user is forcing, and you know it, we can keep this timing information and all, so we know that during this time the traffic will be very high. So either you can do this traffic shaping on that peak internet usage time, or you can do it as a common thing in a static way. So anyway, do some kind of traffic shaping, or do have a control for the traffic which you are sending, right? So on the background, your operating system will do that for you, which is having that network support, provided these things are coded in the operating system. Okay, so in this traffic shaping itself, we have a formal well-known algorithms like leaky bucket is one popular algorithm. Okay, so the name itself says that. So we have a bucket where you open the pipe and the water is flowing. With what rate the water is flowing into the bucket, there is a very small leak at the end, means bottom of the bucket, and through this leak you are taking the data, I mean, and the water from the bucket. So see how fast the data is being filled by the pipe into the bucket, but it can go out from the bucket with a fixed rate only. Okay, a similar concept we are implementing in our what called networking concept also. So this is the rate at which the information being sent to the bucket, that you can imagine like the application, how the application generating the data. It can be bursty traffic, right? So even though it is bursty, the operating system or the code that supports network on the background is letting the traffic come out from your machine with a fixed rate only, with a fixed constant rate only. Okay, and there is a variation of this so-called leaky bucket called token bucket. So for the time being, again, you just remember these names only. Anyway, in your syllabus even congestion is mentioned, but they didn't mention the methods in for detailed study. If time allows, we will see this in detail. Otherwise, just understand that these are some of the methods for handling the congestion. Anyway, you are getting an idea how it is working, right? So token bucket is a variation of this, where instead of letting the traffic come out from the bucket with a constant rate, we have a concept of a token. And these tokens are being generated at a constant rate. Okay, so the same bucket and tape analogy you can assume. And now the thing is that instead of giving a leak and the information is coming out with a fixed rate, we are generating something called tokens in a fixed rate, right? Maybe 10 tokens per second, something like that. So in every second, say 10 tokens are being generated. Now when the application is generating the information, maybe in a fixed rate or in a bursty rate, each packet of the application can take a token and it can come out from the machine. Okay, something like that. So whenever a packet want to come out from your machine, there should be a token available for it. Now how the tokens are being generated? The tokens are being generated in a fixed rate. Okay, so that will ensure that the packets are coming out from the machine also in a fixed rate. Okay, so what makes it different? See that my writing is something. So let me clear it. Okay, so so what we were discussing is two methods for popular, well-known methods for doing this congestion control, and they are coming under the category traffic shaping. Okay, so congestion, that network traffic, that scenario is clear for you. So traffic shaping means from the sender side itself you control data traffic that is coming out from your machine. So traffic shaping, leaky packet is something clear for you. Okay, so just like that analogy, at least you remember. Now a variation of it called a token bucket. So the problem with the leaky bucket is, suppose the application don't want to send data for some, say the last 1 hour, say 10 a.m. to 11 a.m. The application is not sending any data, but at 11 a.m. the application want to send, say, a huge amount of data, maybe a bursty traffic into the network. So suddenly at 11 a.m. the application is trying to send a very huge amount of data, but even though it is trying to send a huge amount of data, in the past 1 hour it is idle. Okay, but irrespective of that fact, what will happen, the leaky bucket will still allow it a constant rate. Now the same thing, you imagine the same situation with the token bucket. What will happen is the last 1 hour, that is say 10 a.m. to 11 a.m. the machine is not trying to send any information, but even though the machine is not trying to send any information, say in every see this is say 1 hour, right? 1 hour 60 minute, say 60 minute, suppose tokens were generating at a rate of 10 tokens per minute. I'm just taking an example, but this is just a trivial small value only, but in general it will be different. So for the time being, assume this example, 10 tokens being generated in every 1 minute. So in 60 minutes there will be 600 tokens already generated, and they are available in the bucket. Okay, now if the application want to send some bursty data, it is getting a privilege, like 600 tokens are available. So the very first 600 packets can take those 600 tokens and they can come out from the machine fast. Okay, so here it is more flexible in the sense, it is supporting both bursty traffic and steady traffic, in that, or steady traffic, we otherwise call it a streamline traffic. Okay, so the traffic is coming out just like a stream. Okay, so we can think of streamline traffic, which is coming with a steady rate, or bursty traffic. So in case of leaky bucket, there is no support of this so-called bursty traffic. It can allow only streamline traffic. Even though the information is coming, application is generating bursty traffic, it has to be converted as a stream traffic. Then in that way only it can come out from the machine. Even though the application is not utilizing the network for a long time, but the token bucket is something more serious. It is considering, more flexible. It is considering the fact that the last 1 hour the application is actually idle. So now it want to send some more data. Okay, let me allow. But still it maintains that constant rate in that. So the token is generated at a constant rate. So even though it is bursty, more than 600 packets can't come out of the machine at any time. So in that way, it is having a control. So this token bucket, leaky bucket, traffic shaping, this is just one way of doing this control. But we have a number of different techniques for making this congestion control possible. So we have a specially designed, internet control message protocol, ICMP protocols were there. We may see this in detail in our, when we go through that network layer, maybe in your fourth module somewhere. So this internet control message protocol is something providing all the control task in a given network. So it is having a support for I mean, many things were done by. So we will see what are all the, the checking from the very simple thing of, most of you will be familiar with this ping, right? You are checking the connectivity between machine. So what is happening on the background? Some ICMP messages are being sent. So like that, it is having a number of tasks to be done in a network that we will see in later. So for the time being, one of the responsibility of this ICMP, Internet Control Message Protocol, is to control congestion. In that, it will generate a very a particular category or a special category of ICMP message called ICMP source quench message. In that, so this whenever there is excessive traffic, so this is a very special IP packet, ICMP source quench packet, that is being generated, and that will be communicated to all the participants who are participating in that in the networking at that particular time. Many machines are being connected to the internet, so a very special message called ICMP message will be communicated to all these individual machines being connected to the network. And this message is an indication that, see, at this particular point the traffic is very high in the network, so all of you please give some control. So maybe this in traffic shaping protocol you can run when this ICMP message is coming, or you can run irrespective of the ICMP message. So like that, we have many variations possible. So depending on the maximum performance, one variation will be fixing. And if you know, we will see this protocol maybe in the last module in detail. Transmission control protocol is a very very powerful, popular, or well-known transport layer protocol. And this is something so special in that it is having its own way of handling congestion control, and that is something most of the applications were using also. We call it as some additive increase multiplicative decrease algorithm. Maybe in transport layer, in VN syllabus, TCP is just mentioned only. If we time allows, we will see how this is working in detail. And if for this gate exam and all, you are getting, you will get some problems from this area. If time allows, I will cover it also as part of this course. So that's all. I just mentioned something popular methods, but if you look at any textbook, you know, a number of methods were there under the category congestion control. So it's a very nice concept that you can do some detailed study. But anyway, I hope you got a brief idea about what is this congestion, how this can be controlled, right? So let's see. Sometimes the problem is that the network is oversubscribed because too many computers want to send too much traffic and the network cannot deliver it at all, right? So that is the situation we already seen. And in such a situation, what the simplest thing that the computer network can do is it can simply discard the packets. And that time again there will be issues, like some packets need prior attention over the other, and if you are discarding it, is so how you will decide the priority, which so we have the text message, multimedia message, audio video, streaming messages, many things are there, and how you will give a priority for a particular kind of message is another topic we need attention. You know, we have a different protocol. So far we were using something called Internet Protocol version 4, and right now we are moving from IPv4. It's a core protocol of the network layer or the network as a whole. We will give that IPv4 in detail when it comes to that module 4 somewhere, but we will see that in detail. And right now we are switching from this IPv4 to v6. The way why I mentioned this IPv4 and v6 is the way in which the packets are prioritized in IPv4 and v6 are entirely different, and there is a reason. So initially people thought like this is how we can prioritize the packet, but later people started thinking in a different way, and you can feel like it is something entirely opposite way of handling the packet and prioritizing the packet, and that we will see in the subsequent session. So you can prioritize packet, and whenever there is congestion you can try to discard the packet with the low priority. So in that way you can add more flexibility into your algorithm instead of simply dropping. Anyway, this overloading of the network is what we call as congestion, and some of the solutions which I given a detailed view in so far, I just mentioned there, like we have traffic shaping algorithms, techniques where we can control the traffic at the sender side itself, and this leaky bucket, token bucket are well known examples, means sub algorithms under this category. Explicit congestion notification we can do. We can explicitly notify that congestion occurred to the machines which are participating into the communication, and the ICMP source conch packet is one such method, like the internet control message protocol source conch packet, special ICMP specific one. The TCP additive increase multiplicate decrease algorithm is something worth noting down. Okay, so many things are there, some important ones listed here. Okay, that about the concept of congestion control. Okay, now the next one, the multiplexing and demultiplexing. Again, and this is something I think you all learned during our data communication classes, right? So simply multiplexing means many to one, and demultiplexing one to many. Like that you can remember. Say so where it is happening, you know, I already told you communication means we feel like it is between two machines. Same, this is machine A and machine B, but the actual communication is happening between two processors residing in the machines, you know. So whenever you want to have a communication with B, in your machine some process will be active, and that process will take care of that communication. Maybe this B may be a email server, Gmail server, and in that Gmail server, you know, for each client there will be separate process or thread running at the Gmail client, server. Maybe I'm just taking an example where let it be the Gmail server, and this is your home PC. Okay, so the home PC, and means when you are looking at this home PC, so one browser you opened and you are trying to get service from Gmail, you want to see your inbox, you want to compose a mail, and those things you are trying to do, and everything that server is providing in the backend support for you, right? And so what will happen at the Gmail server, you will make a connection, and maybe it will go through many intermediate nodes, many things will happen in between. This is just a big picture, an abstract view only, and with that you can have your communication. Right now at the same time you want to have your communication, you opened another browser tab and you want to have this communication with the, say the so-called the the Yahoo server, or some application. Maybe you are trying to contact the CET server, right? You move on to that CET website, and using that you are trying to do some updations. Say trying to access the CET server is giving you a response. I'm just taking an example. Like that you can imagine anything. Okay, so what is the thing, whether it is server side, similarly at the server side. So this is the client view. So why I assume this, because mostly we have this so-called client server communication, and this is a server view. Okay, and this is another server, like that. So whether it is at the server side or at the client side, so like this you can see many process which are trying to communicate each other. So client server side, what will happen? So this is the Gmail server, and this process or the thread will be specially handling this particular client. And now, you know, just like you, many people will be trying to contact the Gmail server, right? So for each such clients which are being connected to the server, separate process or thread will be active, and that will handle that particular. So you know why I'm using the term thread also, because server in the sense thousands or 10,000 or millions of connections will be active at a particular time. So for handling each such connection, a separate process or a further division of it, say threads, have to be active. So you can see a kind of multi-threaded architecture at the server side, right? Because even mostly multi-threaded architecture you can see at the server side. So this is a general idea. So what I'm trying to say, the actual communication is between two processors residing at two machines. Okay, and now let me clear it, erase the screen. See, your machine is trying to have a different connection with the different servers or with the different other machines. So for each such communication you have a different process, and this these processes are actually being connected to one machine, and this is being connected to another machine, particularly another process of the machine. Okay, so this is the actual communication end point. It's a process. It is going beyond the machine. So inside a machine, many processes will be active, and out of them, one of the process will be having that communication being connected. Similarly, this will be connected to another one. But even if this is kind of logical in communication, you can imagine like this. But you know, actually, your machine. There is a network interface card. With this network interface card, it is connected to the maybe if it is a college machine, you can see that this is connected to some switch, say in the Department of Computer Science and Engineering, or it will further be connected to another switch at the College of Engineering, Trivandrum, the college as a whole. Next, it may be connected to some internet service provider. Is it clear, right? So this is a scenario of a particular machine. So this is machine one. And similarly, there will be hundreds of machine being connected to our CS department itself. So this is CSE department switch. Okay, let me take it as an example. And this is also being connected, right? And another machine too, and all of them is connected here. And from CS department, this connection is coming. Maybe from EC department switch, another connection will be coming. And all of them is connected to the CET switch. Let me write like that. That means a common switch of CET. So, see, this is the common thing, but. You know, in reality, the slight differences will be there, right? Maybe the actual designer. So I'm just giving you a view. This is how you can connect things together. But maybe due to different purposes, I told you the concept of virtual LAN. Virtual LAN means physical LAN. So that's such separation. The place where the switches, more than one switch will be there. Backup switch will be there. Many complications will be there. So maybe if you are interested, let me give you this as an assignment. Like you can study our and college network, how it is being configured. Maybe in that could be our assignment. You can contact the technical staff and you can learn from them. So you'll get a more clear idea about how the things are being connected. So this is just for your means abstract view only. Okay, now it is next connected to the internet service provider who is providing service to our campus. They are switching. I'm just calling these a switching element only. It can be switch purely, or I mean layer 2 switch, or it can be a router, or it can be gateway, depending on what is being done. These names were given. Simply we can call them a switching element. Similarly, it will connect to the next main router and so on. Finally, it will be coming here. So like that many things are happening on the way, but something very complex concept to understand it exactly. But still all those things are already built, and now you are just using it, and you are, whenever you want something, YouTube, Gmail, whatever it is, you are just getting the service and without bothering about what is happening on the background. So now onwards you just think or imagine. So when you try to see a YouTube video, say what is happening on the background, some trailers will be coming, right? And that time the what about the delay, okay, many things you can think of, and later on you will do that. Okay, so that about it. Now the question is, at this point, just focus on machine one alone. Okay, in this machine one itself, a number of processes were active, right? Process one, process two, process three, say n number of processes are active. Now for all these processes, we know they want to communicate with the different process residing at a different machines, right? But still, you know, the information or the packets which are being generated by each process should come out of the machine only through this common this shaded this media, right? Whether it is wired or wireless, some okay. So what will happen? So this is the very first level of multiplexing that is happening at your machine itself, right? And from all these process, actually each process is sending packets to different machines and different process residing at different machine. Okay, and but everything is being multiplexed together into a single one, and it is communicated through the common media that is coming out from your machine. Okay, and it will go, and when it is reaching the switch, maybe there are different paths and we don't know on the way, the connectionless service is the connection oriented service is there, the routing algorithms will be running and it will take a decision making differently, and finally through some way, maybe this way or this way, it will reach the destination, the nearest switching element. And now once it reaches the destination switching element, let it be the destination machine, and there also a number of processes are being running, right? And whenever some set of messages were delivered at this point, it will check to what machine. First it will check the machine address, so it will come at the machine level. So once it reaches the network interface card or something similar to that of the machine, then by looking at the identifier of the process, it will correctly deliver to the process. Okay. So now you will be wondering how this process will be identified and how this machine will be identified. For identifying the machine, we have the concept of next we will see that addressing. Anyway, identification purpose, we need addressing, right? So for identifying the machine, we have two concept, like a permanent address called the MAC address and a logical address called the IP address. Okay, so this, what is this MAC address, how, why two addresses? It is something like in your operating system you are using that physical address and logical address, right? In the same concept, you can for the time being, the same analogy you can imagine here also. Similarly here also, we in network, for identifying every machine permanently, we have a permanent identifier, and in mostly in Ethernet and all, the type of identifier, permanent identifier we are using is a MAC address, which is a 48-bit number. And similarly for there is another 32-bit IPv4, if you are using IP version 4, 32-bit IP address, a kind of logical address. Okay, their details you will see later. For the time we understand like this. Now similarly for identifying a particular process which want to communicate, say at the sender side, as also at the receiver side, we have something called a port number. So port number or port address is something that identify a process within a machine. Okay, so hope you got an idea. So this is how we are allocating them, and accordingly we are doing the multiplexing at the sender side and demultiplexing at the receiver side. And not only this, if you are looking at the backbone network, see, to the backbone many devices will be connected, right? And from all of them, the information is being multiplexed through the backbone, and at the receiver side, it is demultiplexed back. So this multiplexing, you can imagine at different levels, at the sender machine itself, on some intermediate node or the backbone network, anywhere. So basically, the idea is same. That is something we already seen in our data communication classes. We have technique like frequency division multiplexing, time division multiplexing, everything you know, right? I think though if somebody is having doubt, just go through your data communication classes and clarify what it is. And we have the so-called statistical time division multiplexing, which is where we dynamically allot the time based on some statistics, which is something popularly used. Okay, so that about the scenario, hope you got an idea at least about what is this multiplexing. Let me clear the screen. See, a multiplexing is a technique by which different analog and digital streams of transmission can be simultaneously processed over a shared link. Okay, so the link is shared. You can imagine at any point, it may be the link that is connecting the different process of your machine to the outside world, or it can be the shared backbone link. So whenever the link is being shared, and whether it is analog or the digital stream of transmission, we can think of multiplexing. So multiplexing divides a high capacity medium, that is a shared link, into low capacity logical mediums, which is then shared by different streams. So in case of frequency division multiplexing, you know the total, that's frequency wise, into different frequency band, we are dividing the medium, and each band is allotted to a particular machine. And accordingly time. So anyway, we are logically dividing the shared the time of the shared medium into different logical units, and each is given for a particular communication frequency division multiplex in time division multiplexing, where popular and which you know. And many designs share network bandwidth dynamically according to short term needs of the host, rather than by giving each host a fixed fraction of the bandwidth, whether it is TDM or FDM. We can see that the frequency or the time is allotted statically, but when it comes to dynamic allocation, that is more flexible and that is more resource sharing friendly, right? So this design is called statistical multiplexing, meaning the sharing is based on the previous statistics on of demand, and there is no predetermined policy for doing so. So that is something worth noting down. Addressing also, I already given you a glimpse, like since there are many computers on the network, every layer needs a mechanism for identifying the sender and the receiver at that are involved in a particular message communication. And why we are linking it with the layer means, so already in the previous example I told you, like when two machines were trying to communicate each other, actually the communication is between two processors and many such process trying. So this is one level of communication. You can think of another level of communication is, even though it is from this, this is something a logical view or virtual view, physically when it comes from all these process in this machine, information will be collected, and from this machine you are delivering it to the nearest hop and next hop, like that finally it will come at this point, and from here it is being delivered, and from there like this. Okay, so the next level of communication you can think of is from this machine to this machine. Okay, now one more detailed way you can think of communication, you focus the communication from one hop to another. So like that, normally we will think about three levels, like this is some kind of process to process communication, which is the end point of communication, and this is machine to machine, or we call as a machine as a host, right? So host to host, where this is something one hop to the next hop, similarly here, right? So we can call it as hop to hop, hop to hop by hop communication. So whether it is at the process to process communication, host to host communication, hop to hop communication, normally all those things will be handled separately by different layers of the operator. I mean, where you are going to write the entire thing as a software code, right? So that the architecture we are following is a layered architecture, where a particular level of functionality we group as one layer, say hop to hop, and all the related things is one layer. Host to host, maybe you can think as a next level, that is handled by a different layer of the architecture. Process to process is another layer of the architecture. So that is the idea. So in that case, we have when it comes to process communication, for that particular layer there is an address concept. And what is this address? Port number, right? Like what I told you, this port number, if you want you can remember, it is a 16 bit number in normal communication. Okay, and maybe in details we will see later. So that is the type of addressing concept we are using at the process to process communication layer. We call this layer as transport layer. Anyway, I'm not telling that at this point, because this layer, they are naming their functionality, their addressing, everything we will see in detail very very soon. Okay, so anyway, I just mentioned only. Similarly, we have this so-called network layer, where the host-to-host communication is happening, and here also we need the so-called addressing, and this is what is our IP address is used in at this point. If it is IP version 4, it is a 32 bit number. And similarly, this for this hop-to-hop detailed communication, we are actually using the so-called MAC address, which is a 48 bit Ethernet address. Okay, and these address, their usage, their everything we will see in subsequent session. For the time being, we have the concept of address, and that is again at we are linking this concept of address with the different layers. That doesn't mean that all layers are having addressing concept, but most of the important layers were having this address concept. That is for identifying the endpoint of communication for that particular layer. That can be a process, that is the ultimate endpoint of communication. But when it comes to the network layer point of view, that particular layer which is handling the host-to-host communication, for it the end point of communication is the device, that particular host machine. Similarly for the hop-to-hop communication. So that is why we have to associate different addressing with the different layering concept. Okay, so this mechanism is called addressing or naming. So naming in the sense, this is another thing that I forgot to tell you. So most of the time you are seeing like www.google.com. What is this? So this is what we call as a domain name. Okay, domain name. So this is something in naming in the sense, this is user friendly. The by looking at this you can understand that what we mean is the Google service. Okay, and you know, this is associated with a particular machine, right? The Google server, so-called Google server, say, or many servers will be there. So one of the Google server will be active for servicing you, and that particular machine, from the computer point of view, it can't understand this language, right? So what it is using is addressing. That addressing itself, we saw three levels of addressing minimum. So let me take the general concept of addressing, that is an IP address, say something of the form, some xxx dot xxx, why I'm writing like this, you may be 162.120, in that format, something familiar to all of you, right? Or something of the form. So specifically what Google server you are using, and that server will be having some IP address of this form. So this is again the dotted decimal notation, decimal, these numbers are like 162, something like this. So they are decimal only, and ultimately this is again in the form of this, you will convert into 8 bits, okay? And those 8 bits, another 8 bits, again another 8 bit, finally another 8 bits. So totally we will be having 32 bits together, four parts, 8 bits each, 32 bits, and that will act as your IP address. Okay, so that is the addressing concept, the binary address we are talking about. When it comes to naming concept, the user friendly name. So why two concepts were there? It is you know, if you want a Google server, so think of the situation that you are remembering the IP address of it and you are typing it, right? And that itself, the Google service is provided using a number of servers. Not a single server can do all these things, right? When the server is, whether it is Google or Amazon, when it is getting popularized, a single server can't do the entire thing. So many people will be handling the service on the background. So at any time, who is free will be giving you a response. So something should be running on the background which is converting. So what you need is a service from the so-called Google server. Okay, and even though there are many servers, for the time being which server can be assigned to this particular user, and that is something decided by someone called domain name service, DNS. So there is a DNS service that is running on the background which will map the domain name to so-called IP address. Okay, domain name to IP address. Again, don't worry at this point. So why I'm telling all those terminologies, we will see at different points. Some of them we may not see also, but I want you to get a big picture of the entire scenario, so that at some, otherwise I can do it like I can break it in a fraction way. I can teach you that also fine, and at the end I can combine everything together. But I think for this subject, this is the preferred way for me, and hope you can also follow with me. And don't worry at any point, like everything will be clear for you. So right now try to get that abstract view only, okay? And keep this in mind whenever I am explaining each of these term again, maybe more detailed, you will get a more idea into it. And something if I am missing out, you can have your own reference and you can link everything together, okay? So ultimately what we need is the, you are getting different dots in your mind, right? And I am trying to give that connection of dots, and normally this is to be done at the end of the course, but I am doing it experimenting it in a different way, and I hope it is okay for you. If you find any difficulty, please convey me when we are doing the discussion session, okay? But anyway, this is needed actually because the very next topic we are going to study is a layered architecture. So layered architecture, as they are mentioning at the first module, means they are expecting the connection to be made at the first point itself. Otherwise, they can give that layered architecture as a whole at the end of the syllabus, right? So like that, I believe, and I am teaching in this way. So the domain name service is something that is capable of mapping the domain name into the so-called IP address, which is known to the machine. Domain name means that is known to you. Okay, so this mapping is done by the DNS server. Okay, so that is why we have addressing. Sometimes we call it as naming. Naming in the sense, this is something. What happened? Yeah, this mechanism is called addressing or naming in the low and the high layers respectively. So that is again low layers means I told you about this addressing concept at the data link layer. Okay, I'm not mentioning the layers, some lower layers. So we already mentioned about that hop to hop layer or the host to host layer. They are the lower layers of communication where this addressing is happening. Where we use the term addressing, and for higher layers we use the term naming. Okay, so higher layers in the sense the application layer, which is directly communicating with the user. So that in that situation it should be presented as a user friendly way. That is why we are using the user friendly domain name. Okay, and physical address versus logical address, just like the physical address and virtual address that you studied in the operating system concept. The logical address is something for the program as a whole, right? If you remember the logical address concept you are using, or logical or the virtual address concept you are using for the whole program, and this program may be a part of it is mapped to the actual physical RAM which is available, and that time you are using this physical address. In the same way, for a very small area of computer network, just like the RAM, you know, hard disk, when you are looking at it, is something the bigger picture where the entire program will be residing, and part of it is loading into RAM and it is executing. So that is the idea, virtual memory concept, that is you already learned in your operating system classes. And when it comes to that, the total means a very small area, let me call it as a local area network. The concept of address that we are using inside this LAN is what we call as the physical address, and logical address means the one which is using in the entire, I mean in the internet as a whole. Okay, something like that you can imagine at that point. So it is something unique in the entire internet, and this physical address is something that we are supposed to be unique in the local area network alone. Okay, anyway, on physical address example I told you, like the MAC address, and logical address you can take this IP address as an example. And again, this addressing concept we will see when we are discussing that particular layer in detail. Okay, let me wind up. Yes. So some of the addressing concept we have are the MAC address, IP address, the port number, domain name, etc. So hope you got an idea about this addressing, and we started our discussion with the so-called congestion control, then multiplexing, demultiplexing, and finally addressing. So you got a abstract idea. So don't worry about that detailed portion that we will see in our subsequent course. And finally, everything will be clear in your memory. Thank you.